Biomolecules, in the last class, we had started disaccharides. Under that, sucrose is done.
We finished discussing sugar.
We have discussed about the sucrose that is made up of alpha D glucose and beta D fructose, and as well as C1 of alpha D glucose is involved in linkage with the C2 of beta D fructose. So, and moreover, it is an example of non-reducing sugar because C1 of glucose is not free, involved in formation of glycosidic linkage. C2 of fructose is also is involved in the formation of glycosidic linkage. So both are involving in the formation of glycosidic linkage, both C1 and C2 carbons. Hence, it cannot reduce as Fehling solution and Tollens reagent as well as Bendix solution. That's why sucrose is an example of, it is a non-reducing sugar. It is a non-reducing sugar, as it cannot reduces Tollens reagent. Or Fehling's solution or Benedict's solution. Benedict's solution. It is due to there is no free group. There is no free CHO group in glucose, and CO group in fructose. CO group in fructose. There is no free aldehyde group, as well as there is no free ketone group in fructose. Aldehyde and glucose, both are involved in the formation of glycosidic linkage. That is the reason sucrose is an example of a non-reducing sugar. It is all data about sucrose. Second one we have is maltose. Molecular formula of maltose can be taken as C12. H22O11, and it can be prepared by
2 glucose, sir.
Preparation, if you observe it, C6H10O5 n times, that is nothing but starch. Starch if it undergo hydrolysis by the help of an enzyme called diastase. It can be converted into maltose. And maltose is a disaccharide. Disaccharide means on hydrolysis it's supposed to give 2 monosaccharide units. So same way, maltose on hydrolysis. With dilute HCl or with the maltase enzyme. It gives 2 moles of glucose. So C12H22O11. Maltose, if it undergo hydrolysis, or you can take maltase enzyme, it gives 2 moles of glucose. This indicates maltose is made up of glucose units. So those glucose units are both are alpha D glucose units, children. Let's try to understand the structure of maltose. It is second alpha D glucose. Label the carbon numbers in both of these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and it is 6. The same way 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So this is the labeling.
Can sir, hydrogen should be placed on the top. Thank you.
Please let me finish it.
Sorry, sir.
1 and 4, both these are connected together. Both these are connected together with the help of a glycosidic linkage. C1 of this alpha D glucose. It is alpha D glucose and it is another alpha D glucose. Right? The C1 of this alpha D glucose and C4 of this alpha D glucose both are involved in the formation of a glycosidic linkage. That glycosidic linkage is C1, 4. Alpha glycosidic linkage. C1, 4 alpha glycosidic linkage. Okay. Now among these two, this C1 carbon is involved in the glycosidic linkage, but this C1 carbon is not involved in the glycosidic linkage. So that's the reason it is non-reducing unit. But this is reducing unit. There is a reducing unit in maltose in the form of 1-alpha-D-glucose, and maltose is an example of a reducing sugar. Maltose is an example of a reducing sugar. It is the structure can be given. What is the final conclusion can be given here? Maltose is a reducing sugar. Maltose is a reducing sugar. Okay, now third disaccharide we have is lactose, also called as milk sugar, because it is the carbohydrate present in milk. It is the carbohydrate present in milk, that's why it is said to be milk sugar. It is, what is the other name? It is also said to be milk sugar. And molecular formula C12H22O11. If it undergo hydrolysis, lactose, if it undergo hydrolysis in the presence of a dilute acid, it gives 2 moles of monosaccharides. That's why it is disaccharide, of course. And among them, one is glucose, another one is galactose. Children, we know that galactose is C4 epimer of glucose. It is the C4 epimer of the glucose. But generally, when you convert in the form of a pyranose, right? When you write it in the form of pyranose, right? So this lactose is made up of beta D galactose and beta D glucose. And the most important point here, C1 of beta D galactose. C1 of beta D galactose and C4 of beta D glucose. Beta D glucose forms glycosidic linkage. Most of the people used to get confusion over here only. Observe it carefully. Sucrose is made up of glucose and fructose. That is 1,2 glycosidic linkage. Previous one, maltose, both are alpha D glucose units, C1, C4. But here, C1, C4, here also C1, C4, both are beta, galactose, glucose. But some people, they write it as C1 of beta D glucose and C4 of beta D galactose. Then it's a wrong structure. C1 of beta D galactose and C4 of beta D glucose. But how the structure can be given? See, observe the point of difference from here only. This is alpha D glucose, no? Beta D glucose in the sense, obviously. This is on the top, OH and H. Rest of everything is same at second carbon. This will be OH. This will be H. Isn't it or not? H. CH2OH. But it is fourth carbon, no? To observe the point of difference, I am drawing this. HOH, it is fourth carbon. This is beta D glucose, which I have finished it now. Beta D glucose. Labeling the carbons. Both glucose and galactose are epimers. C4 epimers. So, rest of everything is same except at fourth carbon. What will happen at fourth carbon? You can write HCH2OH. HCH2OH. Now, glycosidic linkage, here this OH combines with this H, forms a glycosidic linkage like this. This is C1,4 beta glycosidic linkage. Beta glycosidic linkage. This is beta D galactose. This is beta D galactose. This is beta D glucose. And here C1 is involved in linkage. But this C1 is not involved in linkage, glycosidic linkage. So it is reducing unit. And it is non-reducing unit. Finally, what we can say, lactose is a reducing sugar. Lactose is reducing sugar, right? So this is all about another disaccharide, that is lactose. No? Please copy it. About polysaccharides. It's the last part of carbohydrates. Polysaccharides. Of course, on hydrolysis, gives more than 10 monosaccharide units. Then it is said to be polysaccharide. Okay. First polysaccharide example we have is starch. It's a plant carbohydrate. Starch is a plant carbohydrate. And it is white amorphous powdered form. Amorphous in the sense powdered form. White amorphous substance with no taste, no smell also, but it is sparingly soluble in water, neither high nor low, right? Sparingly soluble in water. Sparingly soluble in water. Okay. And then starch actually made up of two components. Starch made up of two components. One is amylose. Another one is amylopectin. Amylose and amylopectin. Amylose constitutes around 20% of the starch. Amylopectin constitutes around 80% of the starch. See, this amylose, we'll be talking about it separately. Amylose, it is a water soluble component. It is a water soluble component. And here it's a linear polymer. Linear chain polymer of alpha D glucose. Starch is totally made up of alpha D glucose units. Starch is a polymer of alpha D glucose, you can say that. So it's a linear chain polymer of alpha D glucose. Observe it carefully. Structure of the amylose. So here alpha D glucose units, we are writing it. It is another alpha D glucose unit. Right? Two alpha D glucose units are connected together by 1,4 glycosidic linkage, like this. 1,4 glycosidic linkages can be formed. It is C14 alpha glycosidic linkage. C14 alpha glycosidic linkage. This one also same. So here it is alpha D glucose unit. There are so many alpha D glucose units which are joined together to form a linear chain polymer. So this fourth one can form a glycosidic linkage with the C1 of another alpha D glucose unit. So it's a polymer. Similarly, this fourth carbon. So this first carbon can form glycosidic linkage with another alpha D glucose unit. Like that, many alpha D glucose units are joined together to form a chain-like structure. That linear chain polymer can be formed, right? So that is said to be amylose. That is said to be amylose. And next, what we have? Amylopectin. Next, we have amylopectin, which constitutes around 80% of the starch. Constitutes around 80% of the starch. It is water insoluble component. That's why total starch is sparingly water soluble. And it is a branched chain polymer. It is a branched chain polymer. It is an example of a branched chain polymer. How those branches can be observed, you will see it in the structure. Please copy this. Let's see the structure of the amylopectin if you observe it. is 1-alpha-D-glucose, you can say that, okay, 1-alpha-D-glucose. Similarly, another alpha-D-glucose. Both these are connected together by a glycosidic linkage, right? That is said to be generally, we can say it as amylose. It's a linear chain polymer, which is having C1,4 glycosidic linkages and it goes on. But at one point of time, when chain is repeatedly or continuously going on, at one point of time, one of the alpha D glucose unit, which forms a branch with the C6 of next layer of the alpha D glucose units. How it can be? Just observe it. And it is, of course, H. What we have here, HCH2OH. Generally observe it there. What do you have? H, this will be CH2OH. And it will be HOH. And from here, H and OH can be removed as water molecule. If you remove it as water molecule, then it forms a glycosidic linkage. It forms a glycosidic linkage between these two. Okay, and in between these two, there is a glycosidic linkage. This is 1,4 glycosidic linkage, but this linkage is said to be C1,6 alpha glycosidic linkage. 1,6 alpha glycosidic linkage. And it goes on, of course. This will have glycosidic linkage. Rest of the carbons, you can fill it. This can form polymer. It goes on. Similarly, here also. And rest of everything is same. So this is C1,4 alpha glycosidic linkage. From this structure, what you can understand that amylopectin has both C1,4 and C1,6 glycosidic linkages. That's why it is said to be an example of a branched chain polymer. In a linear chain, it forms C4 glycosidic linkage. One linear chain with another linear chain, it can form branches in between. Those branches are like first carbon of C1 of 1-alpha-D-glucose, C6 of another alpha-D-glucose can form a branch that gives you C1,6 alpha-glycosidic linkages. This is the structure of the amylopectin can be given. Hope it is clear. Polysaccharide, of course. Next polysaccharide is cellulose. Cell wall of the plants is made up of cellulose. Cell wall of plants is made up of cellulose. Cell wall of plants is made up of cellulose. Cellulose is a polysaccharide of beta D glucose. That's a point of difference. Observe it carefully. Cellulose is polysaccharide of beta D glucose. But whereas starch is a polysaccharide of alpha D glucose, but cellulose is the polysaccharide of beta D glucose. Here also, both the beta D glucose units are joined together with the help of C1,4 glycosidic linkages, and it forms a polymer over there. How come it can be done? Just a rough structure we are giving you. This is the fourth carbon, right? Okay, that is the fourth carbon can be given. And exactly, if you draw it, it looks good. That's why. And this carbon, both these are forming a glycosidic linkage. C1 and C4. If you consider this as a beta D glucose unit, and this C1 and this C4 forms a glycosidic linkage. So such a way, both these beta D glucose units are joined together by C1,4 beta glycosidic linkages, and it forms a cellulose structure. That will give a cellulose structure, and rest of that you can fill it up. This one also can form a glycosidic linkage. In a straight way, you have to get it. Okay, this is also forming a glycosidic linkage. It is fourth carbon here, let us say, right? And it will be first carbon. So if it is first carbon, it can be linked with another fourth carbon of another beta D glucose unit, and it goes on, right? So that is the structure of the cellulose can be given. So far in this session, we have discussed totally about disaccharides, as well as about the polysaccharides also. Polysaccharides, still glycogen is pending. And in the next session, we'll finish that glycogen. It takes around 2 to 3 minutes. And then we will continue with the amino acids and the proteins. That is our next session. The next 2 days, like the Thursday, Friday, we'll be discussing amino acids and proteins.